So, welcome everyone for this session about best traverse practice. I'm going to talk a little bit about mainly about leveling of the instrument and the differences you will see when you're doing your moving around with your traverse bases and your instruments, so we get a better insight of why it's happening. And this is actually not really unique for any Trimble. Tutto station is valid for every survey instrument, but it's good to be aware of. Yeah, I'm working on Trimble optical and imaging divisions, and my name is Robert Jung, working there as a product manager for S series and the TCU, the control unit that you can clip onto your instrument. So coming to a little bit more of my background here, if it's changed slides, I don't know why. No, it's changed. So nice photo from old days when I was out there. I was actually in sales. I have been on for Trimble for many years now. It's up to 30 years, and as I said, today I'm working as a product manager. I have been mainly doing that, actually working with developing of new instruments and system for most of my time. Actually, is to support R&D with market feedback from a surveyor to help them to develop new products. So I'm based in Sweden. If you don't understand the flag there, it's a Swedish flag, but I'm part of the product marketing team. We're sitting in Westminster, Colorado, so we work closely together as a team, because in Danderyd, in the site there, we are developing our S series and SX instruments, and we also have production in Sweden, and this is the only production. Some people ask if we're doing producing the S series elsewhere, but it's coming out only from Sweden. So before I started on Trimble, I was actually out surveying for 10 years. So I have been surveying for like 40 years now. So I started as a surveying consultant. I was driving around a lot, especially in Sweden, but also in some Nordic countries. So you can see some nice old photos, as you can see, as they are old. The snowmobile, it was old already when I started, so it was not a new one, fancy one. Then I was on a big bridge project in Norway. It's interesting to be a consultant because you do everything. That's a funny thing. Also, when I don't work, this is how it looks like, out barbecuing with my boat, with families and kids. And Stockholm has a lot of water around, so it's a lot of easy access points to go out and have some nice time. Or I also like to do skiing. These are my three kids. So let's start and see where we go with this. I think most of you are aware of the principle, what you do when you do the traverse. So like you have two reference points that you start with, and you maybe come back to these two points, or you enter to the two other points in the end, and then you will like to lay out some new points. So what you do? Yeah, you put up your tripod and so on. I don't have photos on that, but you put up your prism and everything, and on the backside, and then you level that with the traverse bubble that you have in with you, and then you're coming to the next reference points. You put up your instrument, and this one you level with your instrument bubble, and then you put up on the new point a new set of prism and lakes, and there you level it with the traverse bubble, and then you measure your angle to this point, and when that's done, yeah, it's time to move things around and swap them out. And then as they are already leveled, you will try to keep it, the leveling. And this is what we're going to look into, why it might not show exactly the same data. And then you measure your next angle, and then we continue in the same way. You level your next setup and you measure your angle, and then you move to the last point and you measure your angle to that point. So basically, instrument bubble is only used actually one time. In other case, you rely on your traverse bubble on all other setup. And I put a smiley there because it's basically it's not a problem. And that is what we're going to do a little bit deeper dive into. So you probably have seen this. Why won't the instrument bubble match the bubble in the traverse equipment? So you try to level your traverse equipment perfectly, and then the instrument is coming, and you can see it might look different. And which one is correct or best? Or should I re-level it at each setup? Try to adjust the small differences you see. Is that worth doing or not? And what impact will it have on your result? So let's start with the instrument bubble. Instrument compensator or the bubble is very accurate. It's half a second accuracy on it, so you can level it very, very accurately. If you look into the traverse base specification for that leveling device is 45 seconds per 2 millimeter. There are lines, the black lines you can see on the photo there, it's 2 millimeter between each of these two lines. But you can level it better than that. So I would say you're probably coming around like 5 seconds at least, or maybe up to 10, depends on how much time you want to spend with this. So now we're comparing what we typically have done. It's a perfectly level traverse base. So in this case, I put this traverse base up on my tri-brack, and it's on a pillar actually to have it even more stable. And then I moved it out and I put in my instrument, and then you can see here that it's actually indicates 59 seconds off here when I come in with my instrument. Or actually, we can do the opposite, of course. I leveled my instrument perfectly first, and then I moved in the traverse base, and then of course it will not be in the middle there. Yeah, and I have calibrated both compensator here, and I also calibrated the bubble before I started, so I know it can't really be much better. So this is really the differences you will have. To really be aware of the differences you see between the more accurate instrument bubble, it has nothing to do with the less accurate bubble in the traverse base. It's not that's why you see the differences on these bubbles. So in this case, I took up three other bases with levels and compared these ones. So the first one I leveled, it was perfectly. And then I just moved the other ones in to it in the same setup. So base number two, it was actually off with two lines. That's about 90 seconds. And the third one, it was about one line, so it's around 45 seconds. And the fourth one was also about the line, but this one was to the left, the other ones was to the right. Yes, we can see that basically all of the traverse bases, they are different. What's going on? It looks really bad if you just see this. So isn't my equipment accurate? Will my measurement be accurate? Can I trust the result? And we can actually comfortably say yes on all of these, luckily. Even if you can see that these differences is nothing you actually have to worry about. And I'm going to explain why in the coming slides. So in the perfect world, you know that we don't have that. That means that instrument, the bottom surface of the instrument is mechanical perfect, perpendicular to the instrument up, and also then down to the tri-brack. And as I said, this was the perfect world that don't exist. And then we also have, of course, some collimation and trunnion axis, but I have not included them. They are not perfect either, but we can correct for these ones. In the real world, we manufacturing the instrument or the traverse bases and the tri-bracks, we know that it will be a mechanical surface that we need to try to make as good as possible, but they will never really be 100% perfect. So you will have some mechanical deviation there in the bottom of the instrument. As I said before, the collimation and trunnion axis tilt can be compensated for in the firmware, so we don't have to deal with these ones. So yeah, as I said more before as well, it's instruments are also different. So it could look like a little bit of, could be in any directions of this bottom part of the instrument. And basically all instruments are unique. So in this case, I did about the same test I did with the base with level. I leveled one instrument perfectly into my tri-brack. And then I mowed the other instruments into exactly the same. And I can see here, you can see that deviation is slightly smaller. It's like 15 seconds. This one was up to 35 seconds. So there are different, all of them. And then we also have the tri-bracks as well. First, a little bit of the principle of the tri-bracks, so we know how it works. When you put down your instrument, there are actually three points that are slightly higher in this tri-brack. If you have looked down, you can see them. They are small round circles, and this level is slightly higher than the surface around it. So instrument bottom part will get support from these three points. And to create these three points perfectly mechanical will also be really impossible. So it will be slightly tilted plane on each tri-brack as well, as there are three mechanical points that needs to match perfectly. And these are, of course, also all different. And the traverse base, yeah, you can guess it has the same problem as the instrument. They will also have some deviations from the manufacturing. And all of them will be unique. So we have at least four different mechanical surfaces that all needs to match during a traverse, which is really not possible. So you have the bottom part of your instrument going to sit down in one tri-brack, and then you have your traverse base that's going down in the next tribracks. And then you probably also have more tribracks in the next setup. So it will be more or less six different mechanical surfaces that you're playing around with in a normal traverse. To just give you a little bit more background on the challenges we have to produce the instrument. As I said, it will never be 100% perfect. A minor deviation of 1 μ is what we call it here. It's like you can see is what it is. It's more or less very, very, very small deviation that will already give you 60 seconds leveling difference. So that the manufacturing tolerances are very, very high, but anyhow, it will end up with something that you will see in this leveling. And in the traverse base, that will be about 1.5 lines, the 60 seconds. Coming to the more important things for you, what impact will it have on my result then? So if we say that the worst case, the mechanical mismatch is extreme, so it comes to the all the way out to the compensator range limit, that's 5.4 minutes, then your error will only be like 0.3 of a millimeter or 0.2 second. But yeah, it's easier to show like this. If it's tilting, it will be an angle deviation there of 0.2 second. And if it's tilt towards the target, it will have an impact of very, very small. But we will never come out to the compensator range limit anyhow. We will be still far away from that. So even if this data is very, very small, so the reality, it will be even smaller. So it will be completely ignorable when you do this. And this is also the same thing when you set up, if you don't do a traverse, how accurate should you level your instrument for off the setup for your surveying? You actually don't need to do it that accurately. It won't help your accuracy in your measurements. You can still compensator is, as I said, it's very, very accurate. So if you don't level it perfectly when you start, you will still have accurate measurements out of the system. I also looked into different bottom part of our instrument. When you move them into the tribracks to see, but these are a very, very small deviation between these two to get to the center. The center position of it is just 0.1 millimeter between different bases. Yeah, which one is the most correct then, and how should I calibrate the bubble? In general, we can't really say which one is the best one and the most correct one. Each unit needs to be calibrated independently as a unit. I have seen some people, they believe that the instrument bubble is digital and you get very, very accurate. So they level the instrument perfectly and then you put in the base with level and try to adjust that bubble to match it. But then you're actually losing that it will not work. As it has its own mechanical tolerances, so had to be calibrated individually. So summary from this would be, you can calibrate your instrument bubble regularly if you want. It's fairly stable, but it have of course impact from weather and temperatures and others, so won't hurt to do some calibrations. And the same to look on for the traverse base and check it. As I said before, then you should not worry about the leveling differences between the different units. I typically never touch this tribrac screws during a traverse because it won't really make anything better. I really do the last one instead. You have a lot of other things to think about to get to measure, to have key in your correct prism types, you get the right constants, measuring the heights, getting temperatures right, and so on. So if you instead spend your time there in looking into get everything else correct, then you don't have to worrying about these differences you see in the bubble. That was what I was going to present today. Let's see if we have got any questions. See if Chantal can help me out.
Yeah, just one question has come into the chat so far. And if anyone has more questions, feel free to send them in there. With the S-Series and a TSC3, when measuring a traverse, it asks for the number of rounds and the number of sets. Typically, I would take 8 readings per prism. Should I measure 1 round with 8 sets or 8 sets with 1 round?
I typically do, I don't see, the question was fairly long, but I typically run the rounds around and go back again instead of doing a lot of measurement to one prism and then do a lot of measurement to the next prism. It's better to spread it out in time. Could that have been the answer on it? Doing my typically round is just doing like 3 rounds, but in both phases to all points. If it want any more accurate, yeah, you can add more rounds, but I typically do all the points before I restart again.
I think that answers it, but comment back on us if we got that wrong. And we've got more questions coming in now. What is the recommended tool for calibrating a prism base? Is it the puck with a bubble? Like a bubble
I think the puck with the bubble is something service shops have used to check their bubbles. But you can, there's a procedure to really calibrate your base. You have to do it in many steps to level it. And then you have this adjustment screws. Maybe if I can go back some slides and show where we have this screw on this. I don't know if you see my mouse. Do you see it?
Yes.
Ah, here you have it. So basically you put up your bubble as you typically do when you level it, and then you turn it 90 degrees, you get it there, and then when it's level, you go back. And when you have it like this, and you think you have leveled everything perfectly, you turn it 180 degrees, and then you look if the bubble turns away on the other side, you adjust it with this one, half of the error you see here. And then you do it in the other direction as well, and then after that, you level it back again with the foot screws so it comes perfectly, and then you do this procedure once again. So you don't really need a puck, I would say. That's I only see it on the service shop, so you can do it without any tools, and there are tools in your case for these ones. It's basically just a small pin that needs to fit in here, and then you carefully just adjust it. And it's very visible. You will see which direction it goes when you turn this screw.
Great. Next question is, would you say that using a detail pole with a bipod would be accurate enough for use as a foresight or a backsight?
I don't trust the poles. I typically say that it's more like, for me, it's like centimeter level of when you do, because you get your prism up like 1.5 meter is the lowest, and it's hard to really level it. I would say, I say centimeter, but I, of course, you can get it better. But I don't really have so much good experience. But if you don't have anything else, it's better than nothing. But I would prefer a real setup with tripod and the traverse base and so on. Depends on what accuracy you want on everything. Because when you do a normal traverse, even if you have anything slightly wrong in your leveling to the ground, you don't touch anything. So I mean, your traverse will still be intact. It's only your arrow you get down to the ground, and that could have, but your complete traverse will be much, much better. And instead of doing it with the rod on all setup.
Yeah, agreed. We've got quite a few questions coming in, so we might have to start answering them as quickly as we can. How big is the impact of temperature in traverse measurements?
It depends on your distance. And now I'm in a metric countries with Celsius. It's much easier to explain in Celsius what it is, because 1,000 meter, it's like 3,000 feet, if I remember correctly.
Yep.
1 degree Celsius change will have 1 millimeter impact on that distance. But I can guess that most people doing traverse, they are not on 1,000 meter. So it will not really have that big impact for normal. If you don't really have really, really long legs, then you have to be very accurate with your temperature. The next problem with that would be that is the average temperature over a long distance. So you have to more or less measure it on more than one place to be sure that it is correct, especially if it's different elevations between these two points. The temperature on the way between these two points could be different as well, with a couple of degrees.
Yep. Next question is, what would be your preferred distance between control points on a traverse?
Yeah, I would say like 150, 200 meter is probably good enough if you want it accurate. It's depending also if you want elevations in the same time. Then you will have actually more challenges. That was my session I had 2 weeks ago. It was about ground refraction, and I could see up to 150 meter it was good, but if you go beyond that, you get the ground refraction problem that will decrease your heights. But if you don't concern about your heights, you can go up to 300 meter or something. But it depends on the result you want. The longer you go, the more other impacts you will have.
Sorry, I just had to read this one twice.
Yeah.
I might read it twice for you, we'll see. The 0.001 millimeter in the instrument base gives 6 seconds deviation, I think. Surely we can check the prism traverse adapter Surely we can check the prism traverse adapter off level tribe rack using the instrument.
Yeah, that was probably the answer I tried to give, that you should not use these ones as a reference. Could it be like that?
Maybe.
as I said, on this slide, when you have this 0.001 millimeter deviation, give you 60 seconds. But I mean, when you calibrate your instrument, that one will automatically be good. And as I said, don't put in anything else there and try to say that this is the perfect leveling.
Okay.
I hope that was the answer on
that. Yeah, I was going to say, send another question into the link if I asked it wrong.
Yep.
Do you have any recommended prisms to do traverses with?
Yeah, we basically only have one, and that is the one I have showed here. Our Trimble Traverse target is the one that is most accurate. We have optimized all mounting of this prism inside this metallic frame and everything. So it's optimized for traverse and have better specs than anything else. So that is our best recommendation prism to use, the traverse prism we have.
What's the biggest cause of error during a traverse?
I think that is typically when people forget about the simple stuff, that you maybe measure wrong heights or key in wrong prism and so on. In other case, it's not much you can do wrong. I mean, it's all of these human things that you need to key in your, what is your station, what is your backside, what is your foresight, what height do you have there, and so on. I mean, everything that is human things, that is probably the biggest. Instruments will be good, and I can also add to this that I didn't say actually, as long, I guess most of all people are doing two-phase measurements with the instrument, then we actually cancel out everything around not calibration of the compensator or calibration of the tracker. Most people use the tracker, but it also take away if you do manual reading. So do two-phase, then that is the best data you can get in exactly that direction and at that time when you measure these points. So two-phase is really recommended to raise your accuracy on your traverse.
Next question. When should the base level be calibrated, or how often should it be calibrated?
It's fairly easy to do a quick when you're out there. You just put it up and you turn it around 180 degrees. And if it's within your expected tolerances, you don't need to do anything. It probably depends on a little bit how much it's used, how it's get up and down in the case and so on. I don't really have at my next study to see how often you should calibrate things. I haven't really get to that piece yet to see what the recommendation is. We typically say have a check on it when it's time to do something accurate. But it's quick to check, so I would say it's not really anything that should take any time from you, and then you have a good view of how it looks like.
Okay, sorry, I just sent someone a clarification on one question. Someone asked, why don't you disable the compensator, like the tick box in Access?
Why we don't disable it? Was that the question?
Yeah.
You can do it. But then your heights will definitely not be that accurate. And if you measure in steeper angles, you will also have problems with it. So I know we never recommend to disable the compensator. It's not really any use case, I would say, if you want anything good.
Do you recommend using an optical plummet tri-rack during traverses, precise traverses?
What was the question? Are you using an
optical plummet instead of a laser plummet?
Okay, an optical plummet instead of a laser plummet. Was that the question?
Yes, for accurate.
Okay. I don't think it matter as good as they are good. The laser plummets are typically also good. So I would say both of them will probably work. I don't see your problem with that.
Great. What would you say is the maximum distance you should be measuring an EDM using a total station? Or like maximum, yeah.
Yeah, the EDM, we have a more or less overcapacity on the EDMs today. I would say, the spec, we say 5 kilometer on it, 5,000 meter. It's very, very long. I have tried to measure it and you barely don't see your target. You have to do manual aiming as the tracker won't see it. So I think most people do GPS on these really long baselines today. I mean, that was back in the old days when we were doing traverse and want to have long legs on it. Today, I can't really see too many people doing that. That's my guess, at least.
Yeah. Next question. So in reality, if the instrument reports the compensator is within range, then the leveling is sufficient for work and there's no need to keep trying to perfectly center the level bubble. Is that correct?
Yep. It's really accurate all the way out to when it's say out of range. We actually, the compensator range is actually much, much wider outside that as well, but we don't really want to use it to secure your accuracy. So it doesn't drop any accuracy even close to the range limit. It's still really, really accurate all the way out.
Next question. How do you do a traverse adjustment using Trimble equipment? So I think they're asking about in Trimble Access, how to do it versus or in our field or office software.
Yeah, I typically just do the rounds that I then bring in to TBC for further processing.
Yeah, I think that's what most people do. Measuring rounds in Trimble Access and then doing the adjustment itself in Trimble Business Center, our office software. But if you do want to do the adjustment in the field, it's in the COGO menu inside of Trimble Access.
Okay, I haven't used that. Thanks.
Yeah, no worries. Sorry, I'm skipping that. I'm going to answer that one later. Sorry, just a second here.
Yep.
Okay. Someone's asking about it's a general traversing method question. They're asking is it useful to, when possible, to survey like additional stations other than just the backsite to create triangles within the traverse?
I think he wants to do some topo points in the same time.
Just saying, could we like survey common points to, I think, add additional strength to the like geometry of it is my guess.
You can. Of course, if you have chance to measure across and not just going in each, if you can see more than all your points from one setup, you can remeasure all of them. Of course, that's may much, much better depending on the site. I mean, you should measure all points when you, if you do a real traverse or
Oh, Robert, you cut out a little bit.
That's more or less a real network. Then it's, of course, better.
Would someone mind commenting and let me know if they also lost Robert's audio or if it's just me? Okay, yeah, not just me. Thank you.
Yep.
So Robert, we lost you there. Can you please repeat that?
Oh, when did you lost me? During the last question?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, what I understand, if you have points visible more than just your foresight and backsight, if you have other points that you will use in the network, you can of course measure them across. It will be like more like a complete network instead of a traditional traverse. So everything more that you can measure to get the better strengths in your network, that will of course help a lot.
Perfect. So back to a question from earlier, I have to scroll through these. When we were asking about the 0.001 mm-hmm. millimeters in the instrument base, he was asking whether just checking the math is correct, and it's 60 seconds of deviation and not 6 seconds.
Oh, he coming to six. It's 60. It depends. Probably you have to count on your radius on your or your height up to your instrument. These ones I have verified with our engineers, so I would say we are fairly I'm fairly comfortable. But let me know if you have any, we can tell you how to calculate it.
Perfect. So we had one question come in Spanish, and my Spanish isn't great, so I copied and pasted that into Google, and we'll see if we can answer this one. What impact is there on a station point that you've been on for a long time and the sun rotates like over you and heats the tripod legs in a like kind of differently from each other? And then that would cause some rotation of the legs with respect to the point.
Yeah, that's probably on my next webinar, I will cover this one. I haven't signed in for that webinar yet, so I don't know when it's going to happen, but it will come within a couple of weeks, I would imagine. And that's a really challenging. Everything you put up on your tripod, and the longer time it stays there, the more the risk is that the instruments or the tripods are drifting around, and you will lose your original horizontal angle. But it's fairly randomly. So some days you maybe don't see it, and some other days you can see it. So it's and it could be fairly big errors as well.
Is that next webinar already scheduled?
Like, no, it's not. That I haven't submitted that one yet, but I'm going to do it. So that will be around your stationing and the horizontal angles when you're losing and why you're losing it.
Perfect, yeah. So look out for that webinar for more information. I like this question. We've gotten this one a few times in the past. What's your opinion of using robotics to measure a traverse? I'm guessing they're talking about, you know, auto lock.
Yeah, basically it would be at least as good as doing it manually. I have tried both, but they are always ending up with the same. It's other things that probably makes it different if you don't get it perfectly. I would say the tracker is actually, I would say, better than manual aiming, because during the measurement time, when we're measuring an angle and distance, we do a lot of averaging of the horizontal angle and vertical angle due to maybe turbulences in the air that, you know, when you try to aim with your servo knobs to the point, and then you can see maybe the point is moving a little bit from and back and so on, and the tracker actually do this a little bit for you, and you get it more average automatically from it. So, but basically you can do it manual as well, and I don't really see any big difference. And I guess most people, as long as they have a chance, they run it with the tracker, and I say that's highly recommended to do.
All right, next one's more of a general question. What is the best practice for establishing control over a long linear project, such as a road, where both GPS and total stations will be used?
Yeah. That's a challenging one. I haven't done anyone for a long time, so there are probably others that knows better how to really do that together with GPS. Today, I don't really actually can say what the best would be, how to combine that, and I don't really know what long means either, if it's like kilometer or if it's really 10 times longer than that. So it's a challenging, all of these long narrow traverse networks. I don't really have any better answer on it, actually.
Yeah, me neither, sorry. What is the best time, I think, time of day for doing a traverse? Yeah.
It's like on my last webinar when I was talking about this ground refraction problem, and that's basically mostly impact your heights, and that is a cloudy day is better than doing a sunny day, because you get more turbulence and airs, and then of course early mornings are better than mid of the day and so on. So it's winter days are even better, but everyone can't wait for it. But really high temperatures, you have more challenging in these days.
This is an interesting one. I hadn't heard this before. On offshore structures such as oil platforms, there are small periodical oscillations. Is it recommended to keep the compensator turned on or off?
Yeah, these ones are very, very more special, different, because maybe the vertical will also move together with everything. I mean, you have a platform that is moving. So the question is if the height is according to that moving platform or if it's the real height. I think I have seen or heard people doing, and the distances are also very, very short. What I have heard on these type of things, because the compensator will be out of range very quickly on these, that you can turn it off and still do it. But that's based on that your distances are quite short, and maybe you have to check up your heights in another way, because the position of the point will still be good. Then it's the height that will be the main problem. And the platform is also, where is the height? Is it the real height or the according to the object itself when it's moving?
How are we doing on time? Like, this webinar was supposed to go until 9, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I think let's answer as many questions as we can in the next 10 minutes, and then after that we can. Yeah, we can try it. Well, we can try to answer afterwards, typing the answers if we can. How do you calibrate the optical plummet of a tribrac?
The optical plummet on the tribrac. Okay. On you see my mouse, this one? You see
yes.
It? My mouse?
Yeah, sorry, I had to move my other window.
Oh, yeah. These are fairly easy because when you have calibrated your instruments, you have everything up set up. There are three screws in the bottom and the tools are in your instrument box case, should be there if no one have taken them out. And as there are three screws, you screw on the one that looks most sense. They are fairly easy to adjust. The only thing that you can't really just tighten them all the time, because after a while you will probably break it. So it has to be a little bit sensitive, of course. But I have never really heard anyone doing any bad things on them. And they are, I think there are spare parts on it if you destroy it. I would say fairly easy to adjust them.
Okay, next question. Could you traverse with reflectorless DR turned on?
Yeah, you can. I would say still the prism is what we prefer, but that's basically not really any bigger differences. I mean, the traverse prism is optimized for its center position and everything around that, but you can of course do it with your, but expect slightly less good accuracy on it, but we're talking just millimeter differences, I would say, very small.
Is it okay to use different types of prisms during traversing, such as a 360 prism?
Yeah, that's about the same again. They are less accurate, but you can mix if you want to. But expect slightly worse result is what you can, what we can say.
Yep, definitely. They also asked if it's okay to use different types like from Seiko. I think that's probably because the, yeah, exactly. General traverse question, where short control legs are required through a sight traverse, like less than 50 meters, for accuracy, would you try to keep the backsight and foresight a similar length, or would you always come off like making each leg as long as possible?
Yeah, that's a challenge if you have a very short backsight and try to shoot something very long after that. I would try to avoid it to be really too big differences, at least. I mean, don't do like five times the backsight, maybe twice or not more than that.
I think maybe we covered this earlier, but there, someone's asking, is manual aiming better than auto lock and a 360 prism?
Yeah, we covered that, I would say. I would say manual or auto lock are equal good. But it's easier to be focused by using a tracker instead of try to look through the telescope a whole day. So I would say in the long term, it would be better with a tracker.
Can heights be ignored during a traverse if you're planning on leveling points with a precise level?
I think so. I mean, it's you can just run it and ignore that you will get maybe warnings for heights. I haven't really done that, so I'm not sure what the real answer is. But I assume that you can really just run it without keying in any instrument and target heights and just get the position and then do some type of Dini and add that heights instead.
Sorry, just a minute. I'm trying to find.
Yep, I've
got a few questions that I'll So for everyone that's in the webinar, we get all of your emails along, like we get your name and your email along with your questions. So there's a few in here that I'll follow up with you afterwards because I just need some clarification.
Yep, we do. We take care of them.
Kind of a general total station question. What impact do the error values have that you're given when collimating?
Not 100% sure what the question is about, but the instrument has a collimation error that you can measure up and store, and that more or less just to secure that you can get accurate measurement in one phase. And as I said before, as long as you do two-phase measurements, you don't have to bother about it. You maybe can see when you do a traverse that it indicates that you have deviations from your rounds in phase one and phase two. That means that your single-phase measurement would be good to get the instrument calibration on it. But in other case, it's for single-phase measurements. Why we do these collimation measurements for traverse or two-phase, they are canceled out automatically.
Yeah, good point. Okay, that's, like I said, I still have a handful that we need to follow up with, but that's actually the end of the new list.
Okay.
And there's